Okay, so welcome to the last day session. Now, Ramanan will talk about some rationality questions regarding hyper-elliptic curves.
Thank you. Buenos dias, everybody. And it's great to be here on the 60th birthday, or is it 62nd? I don't know. 60 plus. 60 plus of Oscar. I met him, I don't know, some 35 years ago at, Paris. And then I've been meeting him in various places, in India, in United States, in Mexico, this, that, and so on, and Europe, of course. And it's been always a pleasure. He's one of my very close friends, as you will see here. It gives me great pleasure. He's one of my closest friends, although he's at a distance much of the time. And we also collaborated mathematically. I wish him and Claudia many happy and healthy years. And I am the oldest person speaking in this conference. And in our culture, that gives me the status of not only greeting him, but actually blessing him. So I have great pleasure in also wishing him all the best, very happy. And particularly in these COVID years, the COVID-free future. So let me get back to the business. So my talk involves the following things. Pencil of quadrics, hyper-elliptic curves, and vector bundles on hyper-elliptic curves. After all, this is an algebraic geometric vector bundle conference. And I'll also talk about Brouwer group, which has to do with some applications of what I have done recently. So it is number theoretic. So I'll explain what that is. So what I had done some 50 years ago with Narasimhan, and later with Usha Desai, one of my students. And I have been interested in vector bundles on curves for a very long time. And this, particularly on hyper-elliptic curves, I had done all those work. And recently what I did was to go through it again over a field. I am a geometer, and therefore all the earlier work was over complex numbers. And if you like algebraically closed fields of characteristic zero, it works. But recently I had to do it. I did everything over a number field, so that can be applied in by number theories. So I'll first talk about what I did and how I reworked my thing so that it will work for arbitrary fields. And later, in the later half or later third of this lecture, I'll explain how it was used to prove some number theoretic questions. I'm not an expert on number theory, but I'll explain how this has been used by one of my colleagues who is a number theorist. So let me get on to the work. So as I said, K will be a field of characteristic zero. And in fact, it'll be a number field, and later it'll be a totally imaginary number field. That is, it is no real avatars. And L will be a suitable extension. I will not say exactly what it is. It can even be the separable closure, algebraic closure in this case. It can be C, it can be a finite extension, finite Galois extension of a field, so that it works in the original setup. U is a two-dimensional vector space. You can think of it as P1, because mostly I'll use PU. Or you can take gamma U, O1. O1 is the generator of the Picard, positive. And V is a 2G plus 2-dimensional K vector space. So you'll simply say P, if at all, PU, it's a P1. So what's a pencil of quadrics? That's the first thing which I said. It's a linear embedding of U in quadratic forms on V. In other words, for every U, you have a corresponding quadratic form on V. And you can also think of it as gamma U O1 to gamma P PV O2, because this will be gamma O1 will be U star. U and U star can be identified, V and V star can be identified. So I won't be very specific about that, but so you can think of it projectively as gamma P O1 to gamma PV O2, if you like. You will assume that this map is generic in the following sense, that for most U in U, the corresponding quadratic form is non-degenerate. That means except for finitely many points of PU, that is in P1, this is non-degenerate. And those which are not will be only rank 1 less. So certain points, it may be a cone rather than a quadratic form, non-degenerate quadratic form. You may simply say that, and also the multiplicity will be 1. So you may simply say that degenerate quadrics form a smooth subvariety. I'm saying smooth subvariety of P. P itself is one-dimensional, so subvariety will be zero-dimensional, but it will be different points. Since it's over K, I said it is a smooth variety. There is no multiplicity. That is, if you go to the algebraic closure, it will be 2G plus 2 points, 2G plus 2 distinct points. They correspond to degenerate quadratic forms in this pencil. So if there's a pencil, then for every U, you have a quadratic form, as I said. So it's a map from B to B star. And if you assume, you can take its determinant, and you can trivialize determinant V if you like. Then this depends as a polynomial on polynomial of degree 2g plus 2, because V is, so you have a symmetric matrix corresponding to every U, you take the determinant. So you get a 2g plus 2 polynomial in U, and technically you multiply by minus 1 to g plus 1 to call it a discriminant of the pencil. So you get, if you have a pencil, if you have a you have an element of, if you like, S2G plus 2 U star, or you can think of it as gamma PU O 2G plus 2. Okay, 2G plus 2 degree divisor. So our genericity assumption is that the discriminant defines a smooth subvariety, that is, the D points are distinct. the 2g plus 2 points are distinct in the algebraic closure. But on this, you can say it's a smooth subvariety of zero dimensional smooth subvariety defined over k. Okay. That's what I've written. There is also a subvariety of dimension of length 2g plus 2 because it's a, it's a zero dimensional. And so you can also give on PV, so take any degenerate quadratic form on this. And as I said, its null space is only one dimensional. So it, when it degenerates into only rank one less. And therefore, the kernel, V to V star, will be one dimensional. That is what I'm saying. That QU of V, V is zero. That is, it's orthogonal to the whole of V. That is the null space. Our suitable extension, this consists of a lot of one-dimensional subspaces of the null spaces of the singular quadrant. Is it clear? So you have a zero-dimensional subvariety of U and a zero-dimensional subvariety of V, namely the null spaces corresponding to the degenerate quadrics of the pencil. Thus, you can identify this degenerate quadrics in U and the null spaces of the degenerate quadrics in V. You can identify, and V can be written as sum of NU. And I'll explain. If you take, I don't know whether I have written it there. Yeah, in any case, there may be a repetition, but I'll explain. Suppose you take two different quadrics of the pencil, then since it's two-dimensional, every quadric of the pencil is a linear combination of these two, right? You can write it as AQ plus BQ prime. If you take Q and Q prime, two distinct quadratic form of the pencil, you can, everything is a linear combination of those, these two. And in particular, if you take two degenerate pencils, also degenerate quadrics of the pencil, they also generate the whole thing. And suppose NU and NV are two, or NU and NU prime are two null spaces of degenerate quadrics of the pencil, then they are both orthogonal. Because NU is orthogonal to everything according to Q, NU prime is orthogonal to everything by U prime. And therefore, NU and NU prime in any case are orthogonal for both U and U prime, and therefore to all linear combinations of those. Therefore, so what do we conclude? That if you take two null spaces of degenerate quadrics, they are orthogonal for these two quadratic forms, and therefore for all quadratic forms. So every quadratic form of the pencil, NU and NU prime are orthogonal, and therefore you can write all the quadrics as summation AI XI prime square in the algebraic closure, or in L, as I said. So you can identify D with N. As I said, D is the degenerate quadrics, N is the null spaces of the corresponding quadrics. These two are all both isomorphic. But then if you restrict to D, O1 of in PV, and restrict to N from PV and in from PU, you can take O1 and restrict. These two are not the same. This is O1 and that's O2. So (clears throat) So, so in terms of these two, you can write down, after all, P1 can be reduced to gamma DO1. Gamma DO1 is gamma NO2, and so on. So you can, in terms of these, you can write down. So you have, in other words, this is another way of saying, technical way of saying, the two quadrants, the all the quadrants can be written as sigma AI XI square with respect to a suitable basis in the in an extension. So that is about the pencil. Now I can talk about hyper-elliptic curves. As I said, the discriminant of the pencil is an element of S2G plus 2. You start, that is, in other words, homogeneous polynomial of degree 2G plus 2 in two variables. And you can take spec O plus O minus G minus 1 and make it an algebra. Why? Because O is already an algebra. And O minus G minus 1 is a O module, therefore you can multiply. And if you take two elements of O minus G minus 1, the tensor product will give you an element of O minus 2G minus 2. And use this homogeneous polynomial to go to O. And therefore, that gives you an algebra structure in O plus O minus G minus 1. And therefore, it's a coherent sheaf of algebras. So you can take the spec. So you get a two-sheeted covering of P. And that is a hyper-elliptic curve. So this hyper-elliptic curve over L is ramified exactly at these points, at the zeros of this homogeneous polynomial. That is corresponding to degenerate quadrants of the pencil, if you start with a pencil. Now, these are well known, I'll recall that. So that way you have a two-sheeted covering of P1 ramified at 2G plus 2 points. And this two-sheeted covering therefore gives you an involution of the hyper-elliptic involution of the hyper-elliptic curve. And there is a fixed points of this. These are called, this is called the Weierstrass divisor. And it consists of 2G plus 2 points geometrically. That means if you go to an extension, otherwise it's a zero dimensional variety of length 2G plus 2. And these ramified, so these points are mapped by the two-sheeted covering isomorphically onto the points D of the pencil. So if you start with a pencil, it gives you a discriminant. And the discriminant gives you a two-sheeted covering, a hyper-elliptic curve. So to every pencil of quadrants, you can give a hyper-elliptic curve. So one geometric way originally we thought of was you take, for every point of U, you do have a quadratic form. And the quadratic form, so it is parameterized by the set of quadratic forms over the algebraic closure or OC, or parameterized by P1. And for every point of P1, you have a quadric, and the quadric has maximal isotropic subspaces. And if it is non-degenerate, it has two connected components. The maximal isotropic spaces have two connected components. So these are the two points over P1 in this two-sheeted covering. And if it is degenerate, just one degenerate, as I said, then the maximal isotropic spaces is still G plus one dimensional, but that is connected. So that is why it is ramified at those points. So you can think of them geometrically like that. Now the pullback of O1 on to C on in P to C is of degree 2, and because the two sheet covering, and it is defined over K, and for every line bundle you can check on C. C tensor, this involution I start psi. Sometimes I write I psi, sometimes I write I start psi. It doesn't matter, it's an involution. And the tensor product is H power D, where H is the pullback of O1. So this is called the hyper-elliptic divisor. So it comes with a hyper-elliptic divisor. And the map given by the linear system of H is simply the map of projection C to P1. Thus, every pencil gives rise, as I said, to a hyperelliptic curve. And incidentally, H power G minus 1 is the canonical divisor on divisor class in C. While, yeah, so now the key point is over K, it is not true that every such element F is the discriminant of a pencil. That is, in other words, given every pencil, you get a curve. But given a curve, you don't always get a pencil. Okay, every curve does not arise this way. Because if you are given a hyperelliptic curve, the set of points on the base where it is ramified gives you a 2g plus 2 homogeneous polynomial, but this may not be any 2g plus 2 dimensional homogeneous polynomial in two variables, need not be the discriminant of a pencil. So it may not arise from a pencil. But however, if you assume that there is a line bundle of odd degree on C, there is always a line bundle defined over K of even degree. Namely, H is of degree 2, and therefore powers of H will give you line bundles of even degree. But there may not be any odd degree divisor at all on C. But if there is one, then one can show that it comes from a pencil. So I'm going to give you the proof of that. Now it's easily seen that that to assume that C has a line bundle of odd degree is equivalent to saying that if you take a finite extension of odd degree, then there is actually a point on the hyperelliptic curve. As you know, no, we are all this. Actually, I think the conference itself says geometric. So we are all geometric, and therefore we think there are a variety is has a lot of points, but there are pointless varieties. So so the hyperelliptic curve may not have a point at all. So in particular, it may not, in general, it may not even have a line bundle of odd degree. But however, in an odd extension, to assume that it has a line bundle of odd degree is equivalent to assuming that it is an odd extension of K, odd Galois extension of K. There is actually a point on the hyperelliptic curve. Now, once you have odd degree, then you can use powers of H to get line bundles of any degree, any odd degree. If you have one odd degree, powers of H will give you even degrees of any even degree. Therefore, you can get line bundles of any degree. So you cannot, you may as well say there is a line bundle of degree one, but it may not be a point. But in an odd extension, it is. So in particular, there is alignment of a degree 2g minus 1. You can take x power suitable power and take your odd degree thing and then get some 2g minus 1. Now, as I said, if it is of degree d, psi tensor I star psi is x power d. So, in particular, psi tensor I star psi is h power 2g minus 1. D in this case is 2g minus 1. Now, therefore, there is a quadratic map. Now, W is the restriction to this zero dimensional subvariety, namely the ramification points of the map pi from C to P1, the fixed points of the involution I. Now, if you restrict it, I star psi is the same as psi because these are I fixed points. Therefore, I star psi is the same as psi. So, psi tensor I star psi is x power 2g minus 1. Therefore, if you restrict psi to this W, gamma W psi, then there is a quadratic map because psi tensor I star psi is h power 2g minus 1. Restricted to W, it is psi square because I star psi is psi. So, so there is a quadratic map from gamma W psi to gamma W h power 2g minus 1. Now then, you have an exact sequence, h power g minus 2 to h power 2g minus 1, h power 2g minus 1 restricted to W, to 0. Namely, h power 2g, you look at the restriction h power 2g minus 1 to h power 2g minus 1 restricted to W, but W is a divisor of degree 2g plus 2. So, h power 2g minus 1 has degree 4g minus 2. And so you get such an exact sequence. So, by duality, we have h1c h power g minus 2 is dual. As I said, the canonical divisor is h power g minus 1. So, it will be dual to h power g minus 1 tensor the dual of h power g minus 2. Right, h power by duality, h naught l is the same as h1 k tensor l star. So, and k in this case is the k is canonical divisor, is h power g minus 1. Therefore, this is dual to gamma ch, but gamma ch is u star. Thus, therefore, for every u, you apply this linear form to u star on u star, so you get a quadratic form on v. V is it clear? H naught w psi. I think I can go back. Yeah, it's gamma w psi. I call it v over the. Over the algebraic closure, it means just 2g plus 2 dimensional vector space. Corresponding to each point of W, you have only one fiber, and then h power 2g minus 1, the fiber of h power 2g minus 1 at W. It's a summation of that. So in K, it's a zero dimensional subvariety. You take gamma W psi, and then there's a quadratic form here because hc g minus 2 is the dual of u star. So for every u, you have a linear form on gamma c h power g minus 2. So you get a quadratic form parameterized by u. So you get a pencil. So I get a pencil of quadratic forms, and it is easy to see that this so it can be checked that the discriminant of this pencil is f. And although, as I said, every hyper-elliptic curve is not one associated to a pencil in general, what I have shown is that if it has a k-rational point of odd degree, then it is. It comes from the pencil. And I wrote down the pencil. The pencil is defined here, as I said, by the boundary homomorphism. H naught W, H power 2G, H gamma W, H 2G minus 1, to H1 G minus 2, which is gamma CH, which is U star. And therefore, you get a pencil of quadratic forms. And then you can check that the discriminant of this pencil is what you started with. So, so in case your hyperelliptic curve has an line bundle of odd degree, so which we may assume 2g minus 1, then it is associated to a pencil. So now, long ago, as I said, Narasimhan and I, and later Usha and I, for Narasimhan and I for genus 2, which I'm going to stick to later. But this is, so we did it over complex numbers. So now I'll explain how this can be done over arbitrary fields, over which C is defined. Oh dear. Oh dear. How did it come here?
We're pressing. Go back.
I pressed the wrong thing, yeah? Oh no. How do I go back all the way? Suddenly I pressed something and then.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the only way.
Yes, okay. I think so.
All right.
It was
okay.
In here.
Yeah, it was here. Anyway, I thank you for your attention. So this is what I explained. Now, to every line bundle of degree zero, that is every line bundle in the Jacobian, every point of Jacobian, associate alpha tensor I star alpha, as I said, sometimes I write I star, sometimes I write I, alpha minus 1, tensor psi. So I alpha is also of degree 0. Therefore, alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1 is degree 0. And so this is another line bundle of degree 2g minus 1. But I'm not saying alpha is actually defined over k. This can be done for every point of J, even in an extension, okay? Now, the restriction of alpha to W, I is identity on W. Therefore, alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1, when you restrict to W, it is trivial. W is fixed by I. Therefore, I star alpha minus, I star alpha is alpha. Therefore, I star alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1 is trivial. Therefore, it is still psi. So, so we have a restriction homomorphism from C alpha to when you restrict to W, it becomes simply W psi restricted to W. So it's gamma W psi. Is it clear? And what is the kernel? You are restricted to W, which is H power minus G plus 1. So the kernel is gamma C L alpha tensor H power minus G plus 1. And you compute the degree and then it is 0. And therefore, what we have? We have, therefore, L alpha, gamma L alpha is restricted to W, is injective. And therefore, you get a subspace, and you can write down the dimension. Because H1 is 0, you can write down the dimension. And it's a d-dimensional subspace of V. V is, I recall, gamma W psi. So you restrict from the total gamma to W. So you get an injection, computing simply the degree of the kernel. which is negative, therefore it's not a zero. Therefore, you have a subspace. So what I have done is for every alpha, I have given you a subspace of G dimension in V. So so you restrict this pencil to this and check that it is zero, because it comes from gamma C, from the exact sequence. You can easily see that that way. So what I have done so far is that if you are given an alpha in J, that is in the Jacobian, then take alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1 tensor psi, which I call L alpha, and take gamma L alpha and restrict to W, you get a G-dimensional subspace of gamma W psi, and that's all the quadrics of the pencil vanish on this by just exact sequence. So, but one small point is that alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1 becomes trivial on this, so it is simply gamma psi, right? But however, so it, if alpha is I star alpha minus 1, we know is alpha, so it is really gamma alpha squared tensor psi. I write it as I star alpha inverse, but I star alpha is alpha inverse. So you will get I star alpha inverse will be alpha also. Therefore, alpha tensor I star alpha minus 1 is alpha squared. So alpha, you may think that alpha and alpha squared therefore give the same subspace, but it doesn't, because you use the fact that I star alpha is trivial on alpha, and the isomorphism of I star alpha with alpha minus 1. So we'll give actually negative for all W, for even number of W's. So in other words, over algebraic closure, you have this Weierstrass divisor, you take even number of W's, and that will give you H power, some suitable tensor that inverse. That will give you an element of order 2, and this is actually bijective, except that you can complement this even degree. So there are 2g plus 2 points, and you take even degree, so you will get 2 to the power 2g plus 1, and complementation will give you 2 to the 2g, and we all know that there are 2 to the 2g points in the Jacobian of order 2. So there is a bijection. What I'm trying to say is there is a bijection of elements of order 2 in the Jacobian with even number of points in W up to complementation. But that's not relevant here. So you have a map there for J to I denote by D-dimensional subspaces of V on which all quadrics of the pencil vanish. Okay, so in particular, I have given a map from J to IG, G-dimensional subspaces, isotropic for the pencil. To every alpha in J, I gave you this, namely gamma L alpha restricted to W. So you can also check that there is an isomorphism. I have given you. Yeah, I think I'm taking too much time explaining. So you can prove that there's an isomorphism of the Jacobian with G-dimensional subspaces on which all quadrics of the pencil vanish. So that's what I have written there. There's a canonical isomorphism of the Jacobian of C with IG, where IG is G-dimensional isotropic spaces of the pencil. This was proved by, this is the first theorem we proved to Usha and myself, but the proof was different. But now I changed the proof so that it will work over any K. Similar considerations also prove the following thing. The moduli spaces of stable vector bundles of dimension 2 and determinant psi is canonically isomorphic to IG minus 1. That is, you take G minus 1 dimensional subspaces, which are isotropic for the pencil, and that's the same as stable vector bundles of dimension 2 determinant psi, that moduli. And how do you do that? I don't know whether I have written it. Let's see, check. Otherwise, it is there. So take a vector bundle of rank 2 and determinant psi, and associate, take gamma E tensor I star E, where I is the involution, and I acts on E tensor I star E by switching the tensors, and therefore you take the minus 1 eigenspace of this, that makes sense, and by Adiabat fixed point theorem, so you have a curve and you have an involution, and you have a bundle on which this to which the involution lifts. And then you take gamma of that and then take the minus 1 eigenspace. You can compute the trace. You can compute the total dimension. Therefore, you can compute the minus 1 eigenspace. And you can check that the dimension is G minus 1. Now you restrict to psi. I start psi is the same as E, and then it acts as minus and so on. So you can check this way. You get a map from vector bundles of moduli of vector bundles of rank 2 or determinant psi to IG minus 1. Because G minus 1 is the dimension of gamma E tensor I star E minus 1 eigenspace for I. So we can again prove the same theorem this way. For example, you can prove that this map is the same as the map we had given. Usha and I had given long ago, 50 years ago. So, since that was an isomorphism over the algebraic closure, it will also have an isomorphism here. But in any case, you can actually directly prove that this is an isomorphism. Once you give a map over K, and you know that it's an isomorphism over the algebraic closure, then you don't have to check anything more. But then you have to prove that it is the same as the map that we had given long ago. So that requires some proof. So you might as well prove that it's an isomorphism here. So in the case when the curve has genus is 2, then every curve of genus 2 is hyper-elliptic, as we all know. We can restate this. Assuming it has a line bundle of odd degree, there is a pencil of quadratics in P5. Which is 2g plus 1, to which it's associated. The moduli of line bundles of any fixed degree is isomorphic. First of all, the Jacobian is simply the intersection of two quadratics because it is dimension. And then similarly for moduli of line bundles of fixed degree is isomorphic to the locus of lines here. And the intersection is actually G minus one dimensional, which is points, one dimensional subspace. There are points in the projective space. So points which are isotropic means that simply take the intersection of two quadratics. So in this case, the moduli of vector bundles of rank 2 and determinant psi is simply the intersection of two quadratics, the quadratics of the pencil. You agree, Oscar? You seem doubtful. In any case, it was proved long ago by Nathman and myself that in the genus 2 case, these theorems. And in fact, we had proved that the isomorphism also of vector bundles of trivial determinant, that was odd degree determinant, even the trivial determinant, that's isomorphic to P3. And in fact, you can identify with subspaces of suitable dimension in one of the quadrics. So then, we had also proved, so on the one hand, you have identification of M2 trivial determinant, and I'll write M2 prime for saying determinant O minus P in this case. So then you take the set of points Fe in the product, where home Fe is not equal to zero. And so this is in the product. You take M moduli vector bundles of trivial determinant. M prime is determinant O minus P. And then you take in the product the subspace of Fe such that home Fe is not equal to zero. This we call Hecke correspondence. And these are subspace in the product. And you have projection to the two subspaces. And one of them is actually a projective bundle. And the other is a conic bundle. That is, generally speaking, it's a P1. But particular points, it's a pair of lines. And even more particular points, it's just a line square. As I said, one fiber is a projective space. You can check from, it is simply the kernel of the map. If you have a map, non-zero map from F to E, for every P, you have a map from FP to EP, and you take the kernel. And the non-stable, that is set of points where the conic degenerates, is the Kummer surface, it's a quartic surface. And there is a geometric significance to all this, and this was investigated long ago. I don't think maybe this is not very relevant. The Grassmann is a quadric in P5, so you can explain everything in terms of this. So now let me go to the number theoretic part. So I recall as a Brouwer group, whereas everybody knows it, but still. For the sake of a few students who may be here, so I recall that a central simple algebra over a field where there is a Wedderburn theory of study of central simple algebras. So the central simple algebra is a matrix algebra over a division algebra, and it's a central division algebra. So I'll call central simple algebra CSA. It becomes a matrix algebra over a finite field extension. Namely, you take the division algebra, and then you take its center, that's a field. Now, if you take two central simple algebras and take the tensor product, that's also an algebra. And that algebra is also a central simple algebra. Therefore, there is a structure on the central simple algebras. The tensor product of two central simple algebras is again a central simple algebra. This different operation, but if you take a central simple algebra and take the opposite of that algebra, and then you tensor, but that's a matrix algebra. And and therefore, if you are prepared assume matrix algebras are trivial, then this gives you every central simple algebra has an inverse, because the opposite to a new tensor, it becomes a matrix algebra. And therefore, this becomes a group. So this is called the Brouwer group. It's a torsion group, it's easy to see. And these are all study of simple algebras initiated by Wedderburn, then later studied by Brouwer and so on, and Severi and all that. And you take the unique algebra, simple algebra, a division algebra over which it's a matrix algebra, and you can see its dimension. Since it becomes a matrix algebra when you tensor somewhere, its dimension will be always a square. Take the dimension, take the division algebra over which it's a matrix algebra. That division algebra has degree a square, and take the square root, and that is called the period, the index of A. Should I repeat? You take a simple algebra, it's a matrix algebra over a division algebra. Take the division algebra, it is an extended, it is of k dimension n square, and take n, that's called the period of the algebra. So to every algebra, we have associated two numbers. What's the first number? First number is its order in the Brouwer group. Brouwer group is a torsion group. Therefore, you get its order in the group, gives you a certain number, and that's called the period. And what is the index? Index is it's a matrix algebra over a division algebra, and the division algebra is as a k vector space, a square dimension, n square, and the n is called the period. It's one can show. It's rather easy, actually, that the period divides the index. There's the order of the group, the order of the element in the Brouwer group divides the index. And that the prime divisors are the same for both. By going to suitable silo subgroup and so on, you can prove this fairly easily. Is it called Silov or Silov? I don't know. Anyway, Silov. Silov. So the relation between them is called the period index problem. So number theorists have been very interested in this question. Now, I said it over a field. We can also do it even over a curve, which is what we are interested in. Hyper-elliptic curve, actually. And in fact, a hyper-elliptic curve of genus 2. I am going to say something about this. And it can be defined over any scheme. I think Grothendieck defined it over a scheme. And then instead of taking CSS, you take CS bundles. That is, you take a vector bundle and for each point, there is an algebra structure. So you have E tensor E to E, which makes it an algebra at every point. So that's called Azumaya algebra. And you can define when it is central. When at every point, in the residue field, you get a CSA, then you call it Azumaya algebra. So there is an analog of this for over schemes. And I'll skip that. So we can associate to it a projective variety. This is called the Severi Brouwer variety. And so you can similarly define like all we do over K, you can also do it over any scheme. And I'm interested in over a curve. So my time is up. Oh dear. Okay, then I'll stop here. I'll simply say Jaya Iyer and Parimala Raman prove the following theorem using the fact that everything can be done over K. They proved the following theorem. And in fact, they proved many other number theoretic results, which I don't want to, because of the time constraint, I will stop. Under these assumptions, so in fact, I took the trouble of proving it over K, because they needed it in their proof of this theorem. The theorem is the following. C is a hyper-elliptic of genus 2 rational admitting rational points, and K assume totally imaginary number field. Then you take an element of the Brouwer group of period 2, and it has index 2. You know the period divides the index, and they have the same prime factors. Therefore, the index could be some power of 2. So they proved exactly 2 using this result for this. In fact, it was proved earlier for ellipticals. And so they looked at genus 2 curves, and they could prove this. So for this, they used what is called the twisting of bundles by an element of the Brouwer group. So given an element of the Brouwer group, you can twist vector bundles on K by that element, so which is what I have written for the rest. So I have written, I have given the proof of this theorem. Thank you for your attention.
Any question or comment? Thank you. So one of the very nice application of your result with Usha on the moduli space of rank 2 vector bundles with fixed determinant 1 of degree 1 was in the proof of the Verlinde formula.
Verlinde formula, yes.
So is there in this, well, you haven't got us to know what the number field.
I'll take it thing. As a suggestion.
Is there anything?
I don't know. I'll ask Jaya Parimala, who is a distinguished professor at Emory University. And she's a distinguished mathematician. And I'll ask her whether this has some consequences. And some other application can be done. I'll check.
Thank you. Any other question? Okay, so if not, let's say thank Ramanan again.
Thank you.